We welcome you this morning. As you guys are finding a seat, Cole is going to kick us off this morning with I Saw the Light.
To help me sing this one out. Well, I wandered so aimless, life filled with
sin. Just stand and join him.
I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night, singing, praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man I wandered along. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. Then like the blind man that God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Sing it out.
I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
I'm gonna pick one.
I was a fool to wander astray. Straight is the gate and narrow's the way. Now I have traded wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw.
Sing that chorus one more time.
I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Praise the Lord.
Yeehaw! Y'all can be seated.
You always got to throw a yeehaw in there after bluegrass, don't you?
Good morning, everyone.
Hey, that was pretty good. The lessons I'm giving you are paying off. Good job.
That's right. Appreciate that.
I've got a bunch of announcements today, but before I get into those, let's get to our memory verse. Would you say this verse with me this morning? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. All right, I'm just going to jump right in it. We are not dismissing kids today for Kids Church. I'll skip down because There are crowns and coloring pages in the back corner back there. There's also some stickers and other things. All we ask is that if your kids start sticking stickers everywhere, that's not paper. You clean it up after the service, but we would love for them to utilize that. Also, there is a movie that's going to be playing in the kids' church room, for those of you familiar with the church today, but there's no supervision. So if your kid gets a little rambunctious and they need to step out, you would have to go with them to watch the movie, and then you can bring them back in when you think they're ready. I also need to let you know that we need more cookies for tonight. So if you could make cookies, buy cookies, brownies, whatever it is that is in your wheelhouse, please do that. We need them for the fellowship portion after tonight's concert. So again, we need more cookies for tonight. Please help us make that happen. Please, if you have any Christmas card exchange cards, Tyler is sitting on the front row today. If you could give those to him, he will take care of that. We're also doing a special love offering for a family that is in need in our church. We have envelopes that if you want to designate something specifically for that, you can either put it in an envelope or write in the memo on a check. Or if you go onto our app or on our website, there is a designated area that says love offering where you would give your tithes and offerings. And let's make sure we help that family that's in need out here at our church. I was told to remind you that we will be having church on Christmas Day, Sunday, December 25th at 10 a.m. The fact that I have to remember, last but not least, we need help tonight. We need two men to help Mr. Mike Kirby with parking tonight. So if you are capable of doing that, please be here at 5:30 p.m. So we need help with parking to help people get situated so everyone can have a good night. So if you're capable of doing that, we would love to have you again 5:30 p.m. That is it in terms of announcements. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray for the service we're going to have today with our wonderful guest musicians and Pastor John bringing a message. Father, we come before you today so thankful. I mentioned this last week, but it's hard to come into the sanctuary and how beautifully decorated it is and just not feel just so grateful. I know that it wasn't necessarily beautiful when you were born in a dirty manger, Lord, but you have brought beauty into the world through your presence, and we are so grateful that we get to come and gather together and worship you like this and hear a message from your eternal word from our pastor. Father, I pray that you would be with our musicians today, Lord. Help their voices as they performed last night. They'll perform today and then perform tonight. Bless them, Lord, for their willingness to serve you. Be with Pastor John as he brings a message today, Lord. Bless that message and let it touch our hearts so that we can grow in our relationship with you. And Father, we ask all of these things in the powerful, holy name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
You God God's gift of love wrapped in a blanket would be his way to reach the earth. A bed of straw became his cradle, embracing God in human form. One would expect more than a stable, but where else would a lamb be born? But where else would a stately house, no noble mansion, where he would reign in majesty. The path he chose led to an altar where he would give his life for me. A bed of straw
Come, all ye faithful. As I was thinking of this song, it's so beautiful. You know, it says, oh, come, all ye faithful, come joyful and triumphant. But I know in my own life, so often it would be more appropriate to say, oh, come, ye unfaithful. Because so often I find myself doubting or questioning or wondering why. And yet the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the one who came to make a way for me, he still accepts me exactly as I am. And I can rest in his promises that he is the same God who was yesterday. He's the same God today, and he will be the same God forever. So this morning, how beautiful that we can be called his children and we can be claimed faithful, in spite of how we feel at times, because he has saved us, he has redeemed us, and he has called us by name. So let's stand and sing this together.
adore him.
They'd soon overthrow. Pull Pastor Dan here real quick because he does not know this is coming, but is there a John Hubbard in the house? Oh, John, I see him. He actually texted me this morning about singing, and I said, you know, I think you got today off, and I lied. So, John, we want you to come and let your voice make a difference in all of our lives.
Twinsies, Lindsay.
cribs, no toys. We're waiting, and still they had their love for the child they were anticipating. He was born one winter night on a road between two towns, and they wrapped him up so warm and tight and said it looked like heaven's come down. There was a new star shining in the sky up above. By his light that winter night, they found peace and perfect love. If we want to find him, I know we always will. 'Cause a new star is shining for us still. Hard enough to make ends meet. There were only two, the cold, the dark, the hunger couldn't take away their joy. She knew that they could find a way. Precious baby, Lord. There was a new star shining in the sky up above. By his light that winter night, they found peace and perfect love. If we want to find him, I know we always will. 'Cause a new star is shining for us still.
Next one, holy. There you go. I'd much rather do the other one. It's a little lower. Go ahead and give me a little more track, please. I'm gonna sing a new song for you this morning.
I dream of a city called glory. Holy. angels hold me there. They carry me from mansion to mansion, and all the sights that I saw. I want to see Jesus.
I want to read you a scripture. I want to also just praise the Lord for a phenomenal morning of worship and expression of our praise to the Lord today. I want to say thank you, though, to all of the young people, the young kids, especially those 12 and under. You guys are doing tremendous. And I just want to make a request that you continue. I'm going to preach, Lord willing, a short message. And it's a message that many of you kids need to hear and your parents need to hear. So I just want to encourage you, stay locked in, keep being well behaved, and we'll be grateful. The past three Sundays, we have been focusing on light. And I want you to turn to John chapter 1, the Gospel of John chapter 1. Lindsay, I don't know where the clicker is, but if you can locate it and get it up to me, that would be great. John chapter 1, verse 1 says this, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning, all things were made through Him, and without Him nothing was made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and darkness did not comprehend it." Let's pray. Father, thank You this morning. Your light is shining brightly. Your light broke in on this place last night, and we praise You for it. We pray that the rest of this morning and this evening, that Your light would continue to shine through the presence of Your Holy Spirit, through the power of Your Word, and through the testimony of singing, as we've heard this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. I want to continue in this scripture in the next few verses, and I want to want you to look at verse chapter 6. And I want to just give you the call of Christmas. The first thing we see in John 1, verse 6, we see the light recognized. Verse 6 says, "There was a man," this is John the Baptist, "sent from God, whose name was John. This man came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all through him might believe. John was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light, to recognize that light, to realize that light. That was the true light," speaking of Jesus Christ, "which gives light to every man coming into the world." The light recognized. You know, it's good to recognize light and truth, but that's not enough. You can recognize, young people, the authority of your parents. You realize that they are your mom, they are your dad, and God has given them the authority over you. But that's not enough, because you can reject that authority and you can rebel against it. So I was coming into the church last night. I parked way down by the church sign so we could save some parking for our visitors. I parked my wife's car down there, and when I was walking back the second time, there were bubblegum lights on the sheriff's deputy cruiser. And he had this young man pulled over, and I'm walking. Just as he pulled him over, he got out of his car. He's got his flashlight. He's got his hand on his gun and just ready, and he walks up. The young man rolls the window down, and he said, "What are you doing?" And I didn't want him to think I was flanking him, so I started tiptoeing out in the snow, and I'm going, and I knew he could see me out his periphery, and I'm thinking, oh, he's going to think something shady's going on. He looked at this young man, he said, "What are you doing?" He said, "You about ran me off the road." And he was just kind of giving him the riot act. Those of us who drive, we recognize the speed limit. Well, we can still reject it and rebel against it, don't we? And it's not enough just to recognize the light. You can recognize Jesus as a Savior, just as John did here. Says he bore witness that Jesus was the light. But I want to tell you this morning, just because you recognize Jesus as the Savior of the world, you can still reject Him and rebel against Him. The most exciting thing about last night was that we shined the light. We shined the light of Christ. We sung. We praised the Lord. We read the scriptures. We prayed. We We worship together, and then at the end to see all of those hands in every section of the sanctuary shooting up saying, I have decided to follow Jesus and live and walk in the light. And you just recognize it. And it's not enough just to realize that Jesus is the Savior. And so I want to ask you this morning, have you recognized the light? The Bible says that in Romans chapter 1 that if you hear the gospel and you recognize that Jesus is Lord, you can even do that by recognizing him through the evidence, the Bible says in Romans 1, through nature. And the Bible says in Ecclesiastes that God has put eternity in the hearts of man. There is something in your conscience. There's something that works down deep in your heart that you know there is a God. You can call yourself an atheist or an agnostic, but you know, and I love this statement. They say the reason atheists fight so hard that there is no God is because they know deep down that there really is one. And that's why they call themselves an atheist. Because they don't want to recognize the truth. And instead, we see here, even in this scripture, but secondly, the light rejected. Look at verse 10 in John 1. It says, the light, which gives light to every man coming into this world. Verse 10 says, he was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own did not receive him. Recognized, but not received. They rejected Jesus. This week, I had one of our sheriff's deputies come to me many weeks ago and say, hey, actually a couple of months ago, and they said, a young man has asked me to come and visit him in the jail. I said, all right, I'll do that. I put it off. A couple of weeks later, the deputy came and said, hey, just want you to know he's still asking for you. So I put his name, sticking note, on my desk in my study. Another week went by, and I thought, oh, I got to get in there. So I emailed myself, and I keep my inbox cleaned out. So if I email myself, I don't delete it till I get it done. So his name's in my email. And so last week, I thought, Lord, help me. If I don't do anything else this week, I'm going to go and visit this young man in jail. So I did. And I went and saw him a few days ago and on Tuesday of this past week. And I walked in, and usually the visitations are two-way glass and you talk on the phone. But this young man has behaved himself, and so they allowed me to go in back into the guts of the jail, and we sat down together at a table, and he's sitting there in his jumpsuit and his slides, his slippers, and we're sitting there. And I said, tell me. I said, you've been to our church many times over the years. Your kids have been in our church. I said, why are you in here? And he looked at me, and tears just began to stream down his face. And he said, I'll tell you why. A deceived heart. He said, I saw something that I thought was something, and it turned out to be something completely different. He sat in this church multiple times over the years and recognized the same truth you have, but the enemy has so ensnared him and entrapped him and deceived him again and again and again in his life, in his mid-30s. He still found himself rejecting the light. And he looked at me, and his chin began to quiver, and he said, John, I'm so scared. He said, I go before the judge this week. He said, I've been in here almost 80 days. And he said, I don't know. And he's okay for me to tell you this, because he wrote you a letter. And he said, I'm scared. I don't know what's going to happen, what's going to go on with my life. He said, would you pray for me? I said, we will. But I said, I'm going to be preaching on light. I said, I've been preaching on it the past 2 weeks. I'm going to be preaching on it for another week. I said, is there anything that you would want to say to people? You're in here, they're out there. Anything that you would want to say? And last night, as we were prepping for it, I was handed a letter by our secretary. And she said, I don't know what this is, but here. And it was a handwritten letter. And I found this. Opened it up last night, and There on the envelope it says inmate correspondence. And I want to read you just a portion of what the letter says. It says, truly it was a blessing to see you in such a dark time. You asked me about my darkness and I said you should give warning that when your heart is deceived, here it is, when your heart is deceived, darkness looks just like light unless you have God's word. He told me that exact thing when we're sitting in the jail. He only brought in one thing besides his clothes into that meeting room, and he had a Bible. And when he said that night, he said, I'll tell you what happened. He said, darkness looks just like light. And then he reached over and put his hand on the Bible. He said, unless you have God's word. Wow. He goes on to say, I absorb the atmosphere I am in. And what got me in here was a deceived heart by absorbing darkness and thinking it was light. As I have been in here for over 80 days at Christmas time, not able to be with my kids, I thought I was lost and broken and forgot. But as I started reading the Bible, I realized I was never forgot. And even though my circumstance may seem dark at this time, I'm still clinging to Christ. And now I have freedom from self-pity and regret, and I want to help others. He said, I have been addicted to lust, love, drugs, and much more for 14 years. I wasn't set free until I got on my knees and looked up and got real and gave my lament to the Lord. And I could feel his forgiving, unconditional love. I could sense the angels, and he was filling my heart, and I was able to break free. I broke and gave up on everything dark, and light at that moment took hold of me. I sure do look forward to returning to church upon my release. I'm going to stay true to God's word, because the darkness is where I no longer want to be. I love you all. Stephen. He told me when we were in there, he said, if I don't read the Bible, he said, I start going crazy. And he said, I just can't read it. He said, I have to read it out loud. And he said, I've started reading it out loud. And he said, the women, their cells are above me. And he said, we were passing the other day. And he said, a girl that I know, that we run the streets together, said, hey, I heard you the other night through the vents. And he said, so I've been reading scripture. And he said, I read it out loud every night. He said, if I don't, my life's a mess. He said, I get so lonely in here. I get so afraid in here. And he said, but when I read the scripture, he said, I'm reading it out loud. And he said, I'm not the only one hearing it, but the women up above me are hearing the word of God. Isn't that awesome? It's not just light recognized. You come to a crossroads where you decide whether you're not just going to recognize it, but you either reject it or, praise be to God, you can have it this way, and that is the light received. I'm so glad that the scripture doesn't end here in verse 10, but look at verse 11. Verse 11 says, he came to his own and his own did not receive him, but, great conjunction, that's grace. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. You are born again. And then verse 14, and the word, this is Christmas, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full, overflowing with grace and with truth. I want to ask you this morning, have you come to that place in your life where you not just realize that Jesus is Lord, and you've stopped running, and you're tired, and you're wore out, and you're in darkness, and like the young man Stephen, you find yourself incarcerated. You're in here, but you are entrapped. You are enslaved. You are in captivity. And the Lord this morning is opening his arms. In Matthew 11:28, he's giving you an invitation. He says, come to me. Come to me, all you that labor and are heavy laden and broken and in darkness, and I will give you rest. I'll give you rest for your soul. Receive the gift of the light. Receive Jesus. 3 weeks ago, I preached on, I began this series, and we lit up the cross, and we shared communion together. Before we had communion, I preached a communion message, and then I had Eli Johnson come up here. At this time last year, the beginning of December, he was baptized. He came on Father's Day a year and a half ago, was gloriously saved, came up here, knelt at the altar, surrendered his life to Christ. We've just rejoiced over this young man. His world flipped upside down. 6 months later, he comes. He's going to make his profession of faith public. We have the baptism up here. And that Sunday, I believe for the first time, his wife, Ashley, came with him. And he said, three Sundays ago, he read us a letter. He also wrote us a letter. And he also, out on the same streets with the same young man that's in jail this morning. And so he wrote you a letter. And he started out to the saints at Chapel Hill. He wrote a little bit like Apostle Paul. And he got up here and he read it. And he said, when I got baptized, he said, I figured my wife would come and she would, you know, she came to support me and then wouldn't see her again. And he said, but she has come every Sunday she's been able to since then. And she's here this morning. And so Ashley, we've been praying for Ashley. We've been witnessing to Ashley. We've been just loving on Ashley. They've become part of our young families ministry, and Josh and Connie have poured into them. Ted and Becky have been discipling them, and Becky's been one-on-one with Ashley. So 3 Sundays ago, we had communion. Before we had communion, and after Eli's letter, we prayed a prayer, just like we did last night. I said, I would invite you to pray this prayer. And, all right, I want you, both of you, just to come up here, just for a moment. And I've had Eli up here many times over the past year. And don't worry, we won't just say anything. I'll just stand on that first step right there. And so we had a young family's Christmas party at Josh and Connie's that night after our communion Sunday. And so we had prayed a prayer, and like we did last night, and asked the Lord to, if anyone wanted to believe and trust Christ as their Savior. And so Sunday night, we're there and we're having a white elephant Christmas party and dinner together. And Ashley walks up to me and she says, hey, she said, this is all new to me. And she said, I didn't really realize I was supposed to do this. But she said, somebody told me I'm supposed to be telling you something. And she said, I just want you to know, you know that prayer that we prayed this morning? She said, I just want you to know, I prayed that prayer and I meant it. She said, I prayed that prayer. She said, I meant it. And then she doubled down and she said, and she just leaned into me and I gave her a hug and she said, I really meant it. So this morning, the saints who were sinners are looking at two sinners who by the grace and the light of Jesus Christ are now saints in the household of the living God. Amen? So, praise the Lord. We love you guys. Thank you. You can be seated. So make sure. Now listen, these are pups. These are kids in Christ. And they have all they've known is the world. And so making a profession of faith, though, that's the beginning. That's that first initiation step. And so we will love them and continue. So I want to ask you this morning, have you received the light? I'm going to give you scriptures and we'll pray together. John chapter 3, verse 18 through 21 says this. This is the condemnation. And if you have not received the light, and you have rejected the light, then you are under the condemnation and the wrath of God. And this is the punishment. This is the judgment. This is condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. If you're dwelling in darkness, you don't know what people to know what you're doing. Sin loves darkness. He says, but he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen. So you confess, you repent, and you are forgiven that they have been done in God. So if you come to the light, John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus said, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. John chapter 9, verse 5, Jesus said, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And then John chapter 12, verses 35 and 36 say this. Jesus said a little while. Look, Jesus said, the Bible says in Psalm chapter 103, he will not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. The judgment of God is withheld through the cross of Christ and the blood of Christ. And he gives you a window of time in this life to say yes to him. But he says, there comes a day when the time runs out and eternity kicks in. And if you have not accepted and received Jesus, you are going to be lost. And you are going to go to a real, literal place called hell for forever. That's what God's word says. And so we believe that. We teach that. And so Jesus said, look, you've got a window here. And if you're sitting in this sanctuary this morning or you're watching online, you're in the window. You're looking through the window of the realization that you need Jesus if you are lost. So Jesus said, a little while longer, the light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he is going. You are aimless. You are lost. While you have the light, believe in the light. Let's read that one line together. Here we go. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. And then Jesus said in verse 46, same chapter, I have come as light into the world, that whoever believes in me shall not abide in darkness. So I asked Lindsay if you would come this morning. And I want to give you an invite. This is an invitation. I want to give you an invite to do the same thing that Eli did and Ashley did and Cokie Spearman did and so many sitting in this sanctuary this morning have done. I want to ask you, have you received Christ to break in on your darkness and come out of lostness into being found, come out of blindness into receiving your sight? Would you stand this morning? I'm going to invite you to come and And I've got Pastor Dan up here. I've got Miss Ron. I've got my wife Carrie, Pastor Gary, Miss Kristen. They're here. I'm going to do something just out of the ordinary. I'm going to ask these folks if they will come and just stand down here. Pastor Dan, my mom, Pastor Gary and his wife. And if you want to receive an invitation, it's interesting how the distractions will strive to try to get us off moments like this. But if you need to come and pray and say, I want to come to Christ, we're going to sing an old hymn that says, softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. He's giving you the call to receive his light for Christmas. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sing this song together. And if you need to be saved, I invite you to come. Dear Jesus, we thank you this morning that the gift of Christmas is that you came. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us in grace and truth. And so, Lord, this morning I pray that if there's anyone here the Lord wants to join Eli and Ashley, come out of sin and begin to walk in the light. I pray they would do that this morning. Lord, you love them. Lord, maybe there's someone here today that they know you, but they begin to walk in the flesh once again. They're saved, they're redeemed, they know you, but Lord, they've been convicted of their sin, and you're inviting them to come and get their hearts right. And as we head into a new year, have clean hands and a pure heart. So Lord, as we sing, Jesus is calling, I pray that someone would respond to that call this morning. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. Let's sing together this morning. And if you need to come, you come.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. For me.
aren't you grateful for a Heavenly Father who looks at all of us who in our sinful hearts are prodigals and He says, come home. And that's the blessing, that's the message, that's the good news of Christmas. And so we're so grateful for Jesus' invitation and call. I would encourage you to fellowship with one another, wish each other a Merry Christmas, thank the singers. John White's got some CDs and his material out there for you to get. We would encourage you to do that, and just bless one another. Come back tonight at 6:30, invite someone. We love you guys. You are dismissed.